Okay, what I'm going to talk today is about the transformation of the power utility in the state of Gujarat. Essentially, I'm going to look at it from change management perspective. This statement by the then chairman of Infrastructure Development Finance Corporation, Deepak Parekh, and he says that India's power sector is a leaking bucket. The holes deliberately crafted and the leaks carefully collected as economic rents by various stakeholders that control the system. So on this, in a certain sense, also captures the state of power utility in Gujarat prior to 2000s. From that state, you know, how using reforms and restructuring the power utility in Gujarat has been turned around to the extent that it was, you know, listed as second best performing power utility in India, only after Andhra Pradesh. It's also seen as efficient, agile, and profitable, and has been winning, you know, global awards for innovation and customer service. And so what I'm going to talk about is basically how did this transformation occur. Like Orissa, Gujarat also followed the unbundling formula that was popularized by the international financial institutions and power experts. But it did not do it exactly the way Orissa did it. It did not buy this idea uncritically, in the sense that it did not go for privatization of the DISCOMs. So what it basically did is it adapted it to the socio-technical reality of the state. Restructuring, you know, so the erstwhile GEB got converted into this seven group of companies, four distribution companies, one transmission company, one generation company, and the Gujarat Urja Vikas Nigam Limited was the holding, or rather is the holding company. What did Gujarat do? What it did not do. The GUVNL group flagged off with a clean balance sheet even when it had, you know, debts of some 11,000 plus crores. This was converted into equity and bought by the state. The boards of these companies is where professionals and bureaucrats replace the politicians. Decentralization of authority and decision making. You know, until this unbundling, all the decisions, including even recruitment, were being, you know, taken by the centralized authority. With this kind of unbundling, the recruitment decisions for each of the companies are taken at their level, and they've also been given, you know, authority even to recruit out of the government, you know, procedures of normal recruitment that they follow. Separation of agriculture feeders and Jyotigram feeders, the feeders that provide 24/7 three-phase electricity to the rural consumers. These two have been separated, and I think this experiment, even Nisha has, you know, spoken a lot about it, so I don't really need to talk much about that. So, you know, if one looks at this, I think there are a few lessons that we draw from this experience. And we also suggest that there is a need for a multi-pronged approach rather than focusing on one or two of the lessons learned. And so what are the lessons learned, or how Gujarat has actually brought this about? Positive agenda and creative tension. This is something which actually has started in Gujarat since late 90s in, you know, even other, you know, citizen service provider organizations and agencies, where they have been focusing on good governance. And so there is this new breed of, a new brand of politics that they've been talking about. Yeah. Good politics is being equated with good governance. If you govern well, you know, you're good politicians. And so that is what is being emphasized. And so that also has led to this focus on excellence in service provision. Feeder separation, you already talked about. And so this creative tension is basically, of course, there was a huge gap between the agenda set and the current reality. But with this positive agenda and the way it has already, you know, it has been done, the transformation has been brought about, the key is this creative tension. That yes, the agenda is tall order agenda, but it can be achieved. Proverbial political will, you read in the highlight, there were problems of local politicians colliding with the power thieves, and how the people in the strategic apex, including the chief minister, they launched a fast against these local politicians and all. So this is what indicates there was a strong political will to bring this change about. The third set of lessons are related to the managerial leadership that was created, brought in to the organization. One, by appointing good people in the GUVNL family, the boards of the GUVNL family companies. Performance was demanded by the political bosses and was supported by the managerial bosses. Any change meets with resistance, and so this was anticipated even in this particular attempt at transformation. Resistance from within, resistance from consumers and so on. And so since this change was resistance was anticipated, the organization also worked towards dealing with this resistance. For example, employees, one of the major reasons for their resistance was the threat of privatization, which GUVNL did not go for. Another point of resistance for them could have been that once these different companies get created, we could be transferred to any location, and people somehow have a preference to stick to or be in the place where they are. And with the creation of these companies and the kind of promotion policies that they had, that this fear of transfer was also taken care of. Superior housekeeping, which focused on controlling the expenses and increasing the profits, and transforming the work culture, that was done by reorienting the staff, by constant communication with the employees, with the customers. Also, a lot of capacity building initiatives were done. And the last one is technology adoption, adaptation and innovation. I think HVDS is one very good example. Similarly, they've also gone for e-Urja, an ERP package that has helped them increase their efficiency. And the way they have done this is they've created champions across the hierarchy, within the organization. For introducing ERP, I think people had fears about ICT. And so that said, they have identified champions from amongst the employees across the hierarchy, and they are the ones who have championed this cause for the organization. They have used the socio-technical systems approach also to drive other internal external changes, where basically that often when change focuses either on social aspect or technical aspect, it is missing out on the important other aspect, and that is where they have gone for combining both. Like there are organizations which would focus only on the soft aspects or the people related and social aspects, but not look into the technology. There are organizations which would focus only on technology but not look into the people aspect. Here you have a combination of the socio-technical focus. We also attempted to do a kind of force field analysis. The concept of force field is that any system has a set of restraining forces and driving forces, and when they are in complete equilibrium, the state is maintained. And in order to change that state, you need to change the, you know, strength of the forces. If you want to, you know, go for reform, you need to weaken the restraining forces and strengthen the driving forces. And so this is what, you know, has we found that this also has been attempted by the then GEP. Now we're trying to look at this in terms of, can this be replicated in the irrigation system? Of course, there are similarities between power and irrigation systems, but then there are also important differences that need to be paid attention to before one simply tries to replicate the same model to the, you know, irrigation system. Major differences, size of utility. In case of irrigation, you may, I mean, you know, you may find very few large irrigation systems. Second is, you know, performance benchmarks or absence of balance sheet, unlike power sector. Third is absence of a revenue stream in case of irrigation system, which is very normal in case of a power system. And there is a need for a strong champion. This is not so much of a difference, but this is any change that one wants to bring about, you need a strong change champion. In case of power utility, Gujarat could find champions at various levels within the organization, and so for irrigation also this is required. So the highlight suggests, you know, what are the actions that could probably be taken by irrigation leaders. Establishing key performance parameters at various levels within the system, that is to take care of the absence of performance benchmarks. Establishing real-time monitoring system for tracking the performance. Evolving a system of regular communication with stakeholders. And communication is the key for any change that one wants to bring about. How it happened in case of GUVNL, that, you know, there was constant communication with the employees, also regular communication with the customers. Investing in the capacity building of the staff and reorienting them in terms of, you know, their customer orientation or service orientation. Introducing appropriate technological changes as the power utility has been able to do. And creating a culture of customer service. Most important and often most difficult to do is control, I mean, you know, anarchy control by political leaders. So with this, I mean, end the presentation. So, yeah.